Hello everyone, a very good morning to all of you. I am Tanvi Kaur and I welcome you to this series called RBI 247. In this very series, we pick up some important financial topics like RBI notifications, some master directions, some circulars and other finance currents, and we try to discuss those with the help of different questions. So we'll try to focus on different core concepts and we'll discuss those concepts through questions. So before moving on to question number one, for all those who are watching this video for the very first time, you can subscribe to our channel and press this bell icon for all latest updates and the notifications. You can also join our Telegram group. In this very group, we share some free quizzes as well as the updates for all our videos. So let's move on to the first question. So question number one says that RBI came up with master circular on facility for exchange of notes and coins on 1st of April 2021. Which of the following statements are correctly related to these directions? So RBI recently came up with these directions which are related to exchanging of the coins and the notes and the entire process of dealing with different soiled or multilated notes. So let's first discuss these master directions which came up and then we'll read these statements and try to answer this question. So RBI came up with these directions or these guidelines recently, and it mandates all the branches of the banks to carry on certain activities. Now, what used to happen? Suppose you have some soiled note which is not there in a good condition, and you need to get that note exchanged, you need to visit some RBI branches which are there in your city. Rather than that, these guidelines focus on providing that facility by the bank's branches itself. So if we have different branches in our city and we need to exchange some soiled notes or some multilated notes, then those banks should only offer us this facility. So if we visit a bank, it should be clearly stated on the bank's notice board that we deal with the soiled and the multilated notes. So all branches of banks in all parts of the country are mandated to provide certain customer services. So let's look at those customer services. Why is there a need to provide those customer services by these branches of banks? The reason is that people should not approach RBI's regional offices for such small facilities. So what are those facilities which all the branches of banks should provide? Firstly, they should issue some fresh and good quality notes or coins which are demanded by these customers. So if I as a customer want to withdraw some money from the bank account and I want some good quality notes or fresh notes, then the bank's branches should provide them. Moreover, if I have some soiled notes or some multilated notes, I'll explain what are these. For your understanding, you can understand that it's just a defective note or a note which is not in very good condition. So if you want to exchange those notes with some good quality notes, then the bank's branches should provide you this facility. Moreover, it's the duty of the bank to accept the coins or notes either for transactions or exchange. So whatever denomination notes we provide, as long as they are legal tender, like if we give the bank a 50 paisa coin, a 1 rupee coin, 2 rupee coin, 5, 10, 20 rupee coin or a different denomination notes to the bank, then banks need to accept that for different transactions and for exchange. So if we want to deposit some money in the bank, then banks need to accept all these denominations. If we want to pay something to the bank for some activities which we are undertaking in those banks, then also all these denomination coins need to be accepted by the bank. Only if we talk about 2011, the 25 paisa coin was taken out from the legal tender. So 25 paisa coin is no more a legal tender. Other than that, these denomination coins or other notes which have come up, all these need to be accepted by the bank branches. Further, if I talk about some multilated notes or some soiled notes, the RBI has provided specific note refund rules 2009. So all these notes which are to be exchanged or refunded, all these rules which have been provided by RBI need to be followed. So this is the basic guideline. Moving further, let us discuss what are these soiled notes or multilated notes which we can get exchanged from the bank's branches. There is a difference between a soiled note and a multilated note. Now, there are notes which because of normal wear and tear gets dirty. Okay, so रोज हम notes को use करते हैं, इस वजह से वो notes खराब हो जाते हैं. They become dirty due to the normal wear and tear. That such a note is called a soiled note. For example, if you can see this 5 rupee note, because of its use, it gets older and it becomes more dirty. So this is a soiled note. Other than that, at times a note gets torn and we stick it with the help of a tape. They are pasted together. So if a note is torn into two pieces which are pasted together, but both of those pieces should belong to the same note, then and no important part of that note is missing, then also that is a soiled note. For example, this 10 rupee note has been sticked up together from the center. Okay, so this is from where we have stick this note. But if this part, say this part gets torn and this part is missing, then that is not a soiled note. Okay, and that will be covered under multilated note, which I'll explain. Soiled note is torn into two pieces, stick together, or it's a note which is a dirty note. And all important parts of the notes should be intact. Then it will be a soiled note. Now these soiled notes, if we have some such notes, we need to deposit it in our bank account. Then banks need to accept those notes and credit it to our accounts. Moreover, if we want to pay some government dues, then also we can use these notes to pay. These notes, once we provide them to the banks should not use it to further reissue it to other person. जैसे हमने अगर bank में amount deposit किया, we deposited such soiled notes, then those notes should not be further provided to some other customer, maybe in the form of a loan. उन notes को आपने circulation में दोबारा नहीं लाना है. They are already in a bad condition. If they will again be circulated in the economy, it will further wear and tear, and thus its condition will deteriorate even further. So these notes should not be issued to the public as a reissuable notes, and they should be deposited by the bank with the currency chests, जहाँ पे bank RBI अपना currency maintain करके रखता है, where RBI keeps a bulk of its currency, its coins and notes. That place is known as a currency chest. So such notes should be kept with the banks and then deposited with the currency chests, from where they can further be transferred to the RBI office. So this is a soiled note. Now, how can we get this soiled note exchanged? There are two cases. One, if the number of notes is smaller, and second, when we want to exchange such notes in bulk. Now, when do we consider it as a smaller number or a bulk? When the number of soiled notes does not exceed 20 and the maximum value of such notes is not more than 5,000 rupees, then we can just go to a bank and get it exchanged over the counter. But if the number of pieces of notes is more than 20 se zyada hum soiled notes leke jaate hain, or we take the notes jiski value 5,000 se zyada hai, then bank might not exchange it over the counter. Bank will accept that amount. It will provide you a receipt, and later on it will be credited to your account. So as far as small number notes are concerned, that exchange will happen free of charge. But for exchanges in bulk, bank may charge some service charge from you. So this is the process of exchanging a soiled note. Now let's discuss about the multilated notes. Multilated note is such a note where some portion is missing. Ya ek do se zyada parts mein aapka note divide ho gaya hai. For example, if you see this note, the number is missing, this part of the note is missing, and these are important for note to be exchanged. So such a note is called a multilated note. Now, how can we get this multilated note exchange? Obviously, we have some note refund rules, as I mentioned. So those rules have to be followed to get such a note exchanged. Okay. Now, if that note is to be exchanged with a non-chest branch, the branch where RBI doesn't keep such currency in stock, then there is a separate procedure for getting the notes exchanged. What's the procedure? Again, the small number of notes or the bulk notes. If the number of notes is more than 5, okay, oh sorry, it's up to 5 notes, then we can consider it a small number. And if it's more than 5 or more than 5,000 in value, okay, then we consider it as a bulk. So where the number of notes is up to 5 pieces, we consider it a small number. And where the number of notes is more than 5 pieces, but still not exceeding 5,000 in value. Here we don't have anything mentioned about value, but if they are in bulk, they should be more than 5 pieces, but their value should still not be more than 5,000. Then there is a procedure to exchange your multilated note. Agar aapke notes is up to 5 pieces, then a non-chest branch can adjudicate the note and it can exchange it over the counter. Usko properly determine karke wo exchange kar denge. But if they are not able to adjudicate the note properly, then it will be sent to some chest branch where it will be evaluated and then you will be exchanged the note. But if the notes are in bulk, that is more than 5 pieces, then you have to approach a chest branch only. A non-chest branch will not entertain such notes, or if it will entertain also, it will forward your request to the chest branches. So this is the scenario for your multilated notes. Now there are certain notes which are extremely brittle. They are burnt, charred up or stuck up notes. Ekdam jal gaye hain aapke notes ya ekdam bahut zyada unki condition kharab hai. Bahut chote chote parts mein they have been torn out. So those notes cannot be accepted by the bank branches for exchange. Wo notes aapke bank branches accept nahi karengi. So where can we get those notes exchanged? For that, you need to go to the issue office of RBI and it will adjudicate such notes and accordingly decide whether they will exchange it or not. So such notes will not be accepted by bank branches. Now at times there are certain notes where you just scribble out something or there are some slogans or something written like that. So if a note has a slogan which is religious or of political nature, agar kisi bhi note mein political ya religious koi message likh diya gaya hai, then the time something is written on such note doesn't remain a legal tender. It ceases to be a legal tender. Agar kisi note mein koi religious message likh diya gaya hai, any slogan, any political message, then that note is not a legal tender. You cannot get it exchanged. But if a note, on a note, there is normal some scribbling or some stain of some color, koi pen ki ink ka color lag gaya hai, then those notes can still be exchanged at the bank branch. So this is how we get the notes exchanged. Other than this, at times there are some deliberately cut notes. ठीक है, किसी ने deliberately notes को फाड़ दिया है. Then it, first of all, it is very difficult to assess whether a note has been deliberately cut or not. But if it comes into picture, yes, that notes have been deliberately cut, then such thing needs to be brought into the notice of the police as well. Moreover, as I mentioned you, 25 paise coin is no more a legal tender, and the banks which are providing these facilities of exchanging the notes, they should clearly specify on their notice board that soiled and multilated notes and the coins are accepted and exchanged over our branch. Okay, it's very important to inform people of the same. So now let's just move on to our question. So the first statement says that multilated note is a note which has become dirty due to normal wear and tear. No, it's not a multilated note. It's a soiled note. Second one says where the number of soiled notes presented by a person is up to 20 pieces with a maximum value of 5,000 per day, then the banks can exchange them over the counter free of charge. This statement is absolutely correct. Now third one says notes which have turned extremely brittle or are badly burnt shall be accepted by bank branches for exchange over the counter. No, they have to go to the issue office of the RBI. So this is again wrong. So only second one is correct. Answer is option B. Now let's move on to question number 2. This is another directions related to another direction of RBI. Let's just look at the question. So the Reserve Bank of India has given the powers to center to certain bodies to impound the counterfeit notes which are specifically covered under its master direction or the master circular on detection and impounding of counterfeit notes. Which of the following have the power to impound such notes? So recently RBI came up with another circular where it talked about the counterfeit notes, that how should we deal with the counterfeit notes. So those counterfeit notes are to be impounded, are to be seized by certain bodies. So who have the power to seize such notes? Is it banks? Is it NBFCs? Or are they only the issue offices of RBI? So before answering this question, let's first discuss these directions or the circular as well. So as far as the counterfeit notes are concerned, first of all, we need to understand the meaning of the word counterfeit. Counterfeit means to imitate something. Aapne kuch imitate kiya hai, copy kiya hai with an intention to deceive someone. So from the very meaning of counterfeit, now it's clear that what can be a counterfeit note. Jo hamare fake notes hote hai, the notes which have been copied, okay, original notes ko copy karke jo notes banaye jaate hai, which don't have legal sanction, which are not the legal notes, are the counterfeit notes, which have been deliberately created to imitate that currency, which will deceive any recipient. So such a note is obviously illegal, it's fraud or a forgery thing. So you should not produce such fake notes. If such notes come up in circulation also, they need to be impounded. Now, what do we mean by impounded? Impounded mean to seize something, to take the legal custody of something. So if these counterfeit notes come into circulation, then they are to be taken away from circulation. So unki legal custody leni hai, unko seize karna hai. Now, who has the power to impound, to seize such notes? Three bodies have been given that power. First of all banks have this power. Secondly, all the treasuries and the sub-treasuries have this power. And the third one is all the issue offices of RBI have this power. So if we talk about other NBFCs or housing finance companies, though they don't have this power, only these three bodies have this power to impound the counterfeited notes. Now let's move ahead further. Let's have a look at the detection of these counterfeit notes. First of all, the banks need to examine such notes. Banks should have certain machines which will detect such counterfeit notes. It's very important to keep a check on whether the notes which are coming to the bank are legal or they are counterfeit notes. Then once a bank detects that, okay, this is a counterfeit note, it should not be credited to customer's account. That note will not be credited to one's account. Moreover, these notes should not be returned to the tenderer, neither they should be destroyed. Now you might have gone to a bank and you deposit some money, but some notes were not accepted by the machine. Okay, but it's not that they are always counterfeit. At times machine might not have accepted that note, but usually a machine doesn't detect a note when it's a counterfeit note. So it's the responsibility of bank to not return such notes to the person. The bank should keep a record of such notes. Okay, if bank brings that note back into circulation, then it is considered that bank is also wrongly involved in dealing with counterfeit notes, and bank can be penalized for the same. Whenever bank receives a counterfeit note, it should stamp such note as being a counterfeit note. Jab bhi aisa koi note aata hai, bank should put a stamp on it that it's a counterfeit note, and that note should be retained with the bank, and then whatever further procedure has to be followed, banks should follow it. Alright. Now, if I talk about these banks, the banks need to appoint a nodal bank officer. So bank needs to appoint whom? A nodal bank officer who will deal with all such cases of counterfeit notes. Whenever a counterfeit notes come up, okay, if the number of notes which come up are up to 4 pieces, okay, then in that case, a consolidated report needs to be prepared and local police needs to be informed about the same. Who needs to be informed? The local police. But if the number of pieces of that note is more than 4, if the number of pieces of that note is 5 or more, here is up to 4 pieces, lekin agar 5 ya usse zyada hai, then an FIR needs to be filed with the police. Alright. So what you need to do, need to file a report with the police or an FIR with the police. Now, with whatever this report or FIR is filed, a record of that also need to be retained, which will be sent to the forged note vigilance cell. Now, let's discuss a bit about this forged notes vigilance cell. Every bank shall have its head office this cell, the FNV cell. So, what's the role of this cell? First of all, it will deal with all such counterfeited notes. It will provide the instructions about the counterfeited notes. It will make sure that such norms are actually getting implemented. Then it can also keep a check on the banks whether they are properly dealing with the counterfeit notes or not, keeping the records or not. Okay, surprise checks can be there. Then they need to make sure that the banks are properly maintaining the machines to deal up with the counterfeit notes. Okay, random checks can be there where they'll check that machines are working properly, banks are maintaining records. Then all such cases ke jo follow up hai, wo ye cell leta hai. It make do the follow up of the cases of counterfeit notes. It compiles the data of detection of counterfeit notes and then it is submitted to the Reserve Bank or other authorities like the National Crime Records Bureau. So this is the role of your forged note vigilance cell. Now, it's very important to examine the bank notes even before they are put on a ATM machine also. So, first of all, if 100 or a more denomination note comes up to the bank, it should first be checked in a machine. Then only it should be further used for circulation. When the bank is putting up some money in a ATM, then only proper notes, which are not counterfeit notes, they should be checked and then only the amount should be put up in the ATMs. Otherwise, it will be considered that bank is dealing in a counterfeit notes if a counterfeit notes comes out of an ATM. So this is whole process. Now, if I move back to our question, here they were asking about the bodies which had the power to impound such notes. So banks have, issue offices have, but NBFCs don't. So the answer is option D. Now let's move on to question number 3. So this question says that RBI decided to conduct the purchase of government securities of rupees 1 lakh crore under the dash in the first quarter of this financial year. Bank of Japan, on the other hand, shifted in late 2016 to a policy of dash in which it sought to peg the yield on 10-year Japanese government bonds at 0% in an effort to stimulate the Japan's economy. So we have to fill in these blanks. Now you must be aware that RBI recently came up with a GSAP 1.0 program. So the answer to this question is option C, where RBI came up with GSAP 1.0, and as far as Japan is concerned, it follows a yield curve control, YCC policy. So let's just discuss what is this GSAP, how it differs from YCC. Okay. So if I talk about GSAP, recently government announced that it's going to buy some bonds. Now, how is GSAP different from an OMO? You all know that the situation of the economy is not that very good due to the pandemic. So there is a need to provide some liquidity in the economy. How can government provide that? Usually government can go for OMO, that is the open market operations, where government will buy the bonds. It will release some money in the economy, providing the liquidity. So instead of just going for OMOs, government recently decided that RBI recently decided that it will go for a GSAP. Government securities will be bought in this case also. So how does the GSAP differs from OMO? It is like OMO only. Here also the government will buy the bonds, which will release some liquidity in the economy. But in OMOs, the government never announces that on this date we will conduct an OMO and this much amount of OMO will be conducted. But in a GSAP, the government declared that we are going to raise the 1 lakh crore as mentioned in this question in this quarter. Moreover, it mentioned that on 15th April, we will raise 25 crores. So the date and the amount which will be raised was declared. This is how a GSAP differs from OMO, where a pre-declaration or pre-announcement is made about how much bonds will be bought and at what date they are going to be bought. This is what makes the GSAP different from OMO. Now, why did we come up with the GSAP? The bond yields were rising. They were quite high. So we wanted to stabilize them, to basically make sure a stable evolution of the yield curve. Now talking about the yield curve, what's the yield curve? Yield curve shows the different interest rates or the yields फॉर डिफरेंट मेच्योरिटी बॉन्ड्स. सो ये एक लाइन है जो अलग अलग इंटरेस्ट रेट्स दिखाती है ऑफ डिफरेंट मेच्योरिटी बॉन्ड्स. फॉर एग्जाम्पल, वी मे हैव अ 2 ईयर बॉन्ड, वी मे हैव अ 10 ईयर बॉन्ड. सो वॉट आर द यील्ड रेट्स, इंटरेस्ट रेट्स ऑफ दोज बॉन्ड्स? द लाइन विच शोज दैट इज नोन एज अ यील्ड कर्व. ऑलराइट, so this was the basic idea behind the GSAP. Now why did government announce them? Obviously, as I have told you, to ensure the stable evolution of the yield curve. If the government is going to buy the bonds, if government will buy the bonds, it will increase the demand for those bonds or reduce the supply of those bonds. इसकी वजह से क्या होगा? The prices are going to rise. So if government जो है government buys the bonds, if governments buy a bond, the bond prices rise, and the bond prices are inversely related to the interest rates or the bond yields. So if bond prices will rise, the interest rates or the yields are going to fall. So this is the inverse relation. Now what are these yields? They are nothing but the interest rate. If the interest rates are going to fall, then it will make your borrowing cheaper. So if interest rates fall, borrowing becomes cheaper. Banks borrow at lower rates, they borrow more. If they borrow more, they are going to spend more, invest more. So this is going to stimulate the economy. Moreover, if the interest rates are low, then it will also help to maintain the stock prices higher. In one of my sessions where I covered finance currents, I discussed the link between the bonds and bond interest rates and the equity. If you want to go through that video, you can just search for RBI 247 Finance Currents. Recently, I came up with that video. Otherwise, you can ask in the comments below. I'll give the link over here as well. So, the lower interest rates are likely to take the stock prices also higher. So, this was the idea of GSAP. Now, if I talk about yield curve control, I already discussed yield curve shows the interest rates of bonds across different maturity bonds. So what is this yield curve control? When we try to control the yield rates, okay, but with a different approach, what we did in GSAP or something was we bought or sold the bonds to maintain the yield rates. Okay, we bought the bonds taki interest rates kam kiye jaye. But what happens in a yield curve? You preset the interest rate. We set some target interest rate, and to maintain the yields within that rate, we buy or sell the bonds. So here, how is it different? Here we control the interest rate by setting a target interest rate for long term, and then based on that we purchase the bonds. So it involves targeting a long term interest rate and then buying or selling to hit that rate target. This is something which is followed in Japan. Earlier, Japan followed the quantitative easing policy, under which it bought or sold the bonds and the interest rates were maintained. But then it shifted in 2016 to the YCC policy, where it preset the interest rate that we'll maintain 10-year Japanese bonds at 0%, and accordingly it bought the bonds to maintain this rate. So this was the yield curve control. Now how does it differs from a GSAP? As I've already mentioned, here we explicitly announce that this is the rate, the target rate, which the central bank aims at. Okay, the target rate of interest. But in GSAP, there is no such target set. In fact, after buying or selling, the interest rates get affected. Secondly, here in YCC, we also set the target price. If we are setting the bond price, the bond yield, it is inversely related to bond price. So we are setting the bond price also. So a limit hum set kar dete hain that bond price should not exceed or should be this much. So if it goes beyond that limit, then we buy or sell the bonds. But in GSAP, what happens is the government invites the bid, and based on that it provides the cutoff rates. Still, it may or may not accept the number of bids that come up. For example, if you have a look at the notification of RBI, then it wanted to raise 25,000 crores, for which numerous bids came up. Like for this bond, 180 bids came up, but only 19 were accepted. For this bond, 131 came up, 49 were accepted. Okay. Moreover, banks came up, the RBI came up with the cutoff yield rates. So this is how RBI carried out the GSAP. Next is that in YCC, the banks commit to buying any amount of GSECs that the markets want to sell to maintain the target. So the bank has already set the target. It will buy the bonds for that. So whatever number of bonds it needs to buy, whatever market wants to sell, it will buy the entire amount. But there is no such thing in GSAP. There is no commitment by RBI to buy unlimited amount of banks. जैसे यहाँ RBI ने unlimited amount नहीं buy किया. It announced that we'll buy only 25,000 crores bonds. So that much is only bought. But here the Japan can borrow as much as the market wants to sell to it. Moreover, the very objective of both of these policies differ. The GSAP objective was to maintain a stable yield curve. But if I talk about YCC, what was its focus? First of all, any economy will try to focus on its short-term interest rates. If despite of maintaining the short-term interest rates, economy is not reviving, inflation is not there, it's below the target, then in order to revive the economy, central bank needs to change the interest rates. So that is what happens in YCC. So this was the basic concept of YCC and GSAP, which discussed how both of them differ. Many of you were asking to explain this article which recently came up in the Mint newspaper. So I discussed it by differentiating properly between the two. Now let's just move on to the last question of the day.
So this is question number 4, which says, India Bulls Housing Finance Limited has entered into strategic co-lending partnership with housing finance major HDFC Limited to offer the housing loans to the home buyers at competitive rates. So India Bulls would originate retail home loans as per jointly drawn up credit policy and retain 20% of the loan in its books, while 80% will remain with HDFC. The Reserve Bank in 2020 came up with the co-lending model scheme. Which of the following statements is incorrect about this scheme? So they are talking about a co-lending model scheme which RBI came up with in 2020. Recently, a Housing Finance Limited has co-lended with the HDFC to provide the lending. So let's first discuss what is this concept of co-lending. What do we mean by co-lending? Co-lending means lending together. So if one bank together with another bank lends to a borrower, that is co-lending. Do lenders mil ke ek saath ek loan ko sponsor kar rahe hain. That is co-lending. It is obviously not a new concept. The banks together have lended to numerous borrowers. So how was this 2020 co-lending scheme or co-lending model different? That model focused on co-lending between a bank. Co-lending between a bank and an NBFC. So NBFC or the housing finance company played an important role over here. RBI came up with these guidelines which comprised of co-origination of loans under banks and NBFCs, and they can together lend to different priority sectors or the weaker sections of the society. So this was the focus of this model. Here, NBFCs and other housing finance companies were collaborating with the banks to provide the loans. There is one condition which is to be satisfied in this case. If such a loan is being granted, then 20% of the share of that loan should be shown in the NBFC's book. Remaining can be there in the other bank's book. For example, a 10 crore loan needs to be given. Then 2 crore ka jo amount hai, the 2 crore amount should be shown in the NBFC's books. And remaining 8 crores can be shown in the bank's book. Then if I talk about the risks and rewards, they are obviously shared between the two based on their individual exposures. So, as I've already mentioned, co-lending existed earlier. This time only it was with the NBFC. Now, what were the reason that this model came up? So NBFCs have wide reach. Wo bahut zyada easily customers tak pahunche hue hain. And the banks provide very low cost lending. So if we bring together the banks and the NBFCs, then both will be able to reap the benefits and the customers will also be able to reap the benefits. So the aim of this model was to provide low cost funding to the priority sectors or the weaker sections. So this focused on the unserved or underserved sectors where they wanted to provide affordable cost credit. So the banks and NBFCs came up together to fulfill this initiative. This is the concept, simple concept of co-lending between an NBFC and a bank. Recently, this Housing Finance Limited, Indian Bulls Housing Finance Limited has decided to co-lend with the HDFC for what? To help provide the housing loans at competitive rates. So here also, as you can see, minimum 20% was to be shown in the books of India Bulls. So they are showing this 20% amount and 80% is going to HDFC's book. Now let's just read on the statements and identify the incorrect one. So it is a scheme under which banks can provide loans along with NBFCs to priority sector borrowers based on agreement. This statement is correct. Second one says, as per guidelines, NBFCs shall be required to retain a minimum of 10% share of individual loans on its book. No, it is 20%. Then remaining says, risk and rewards are shared among the borrowers based on individual exposure. This is correct. And then the model was introduced to serve underserved sectors. This is again correct. So the incorrect one is option B. This was all for today's session. With this, I would like to end up this session. I hope you found it useful. Thank you so much.